individuals. I was praying, and God spoke to me. And so in a moment, we're going to read Psalms 39, verse 7. But before we get there, let me take you back to 2015. 2015 for me was just a period in life of pain, of frustration, of at times hopelessness. And I know people have been there before. For me, it was actually a time of injury. I herniated 3 discs in my lumbar spine. And they were in such a position that they were pushing on the nerve in 3 places. And it was by far the worst injury I'd suffered. I couldn't lie down either side. I couldn't walk. I had to have crutches leaning on one side. I couldn't sit, couldn't sleep, couldn't shower. Lisa had to shower me. And, you know, I had such severe nerve pain that often there'd just be tears in my eyes. I was on naproxen and dihydrocodone and diazepam, hallucinating, trying everything possible to get free from this pain. But the reality is the medication didn't work. And I remember that season. I felt like I was defeated by pain. I felt like I had no options, like nothing could work. You know, there's nothing worse than being or feeling defeated in life. Nothing worse than feeling like there's no options. And for me, it was a dark few months, but I remember one morning when I literally cried out, tears in my eyes, cried out to God. And I said, God, you got to heal me. None of this is working. And God spoke to me. How many know God speaks? And he spoke to me and he said some very simple words. And he said these words to me. He said, don't lose hope. And they just hit me. Don't lose hope. And so I got on my crutches and I was all bent to the side. If I show you the video sometime, I'm walking to my bookshelf and I try and find the closest book I have on hope. So I get this book on hope and I open it up and I'm pretty shocked to realize it's a book written by a pastor who is sat in pain and frustrated because he's injured. And so I'm reading this book and I'm pretty shocked already. I'm like, wow, how in the world did I find this book? God led it to me. And it was, and these are exact words, and I quote, this is a pastor who has been sat in pain, frustrated, couldn't preach, injured. And he says, especially important during those days was the gift of hope. Hope in the midst of 2 things, the searing pain and the inner depression that comes from being incapacitated. He says, I couldn't do anything. I couldn't preach. I couldn't walk. I couldn't pastor. I couldn't produce anything worthwhile. All I could do was be. And he says these words, this book is the lesson of my pain, but more, it is the lesson in the power of hope. I want everyone to say hope after 3. 1, 2, 3. Okay, I only saw a few of your mouths moving. I wanted to hear it so loud that it comes all the way to the UK. Everyone say hope after 3. 1, 2, 3. Hope. Hope. You see, in that dark season, I learned a 5-word statement that's in our psalm. So let's look at it. Psalms 39, 7. And it's the last 5 words of that verse. And I learned in that season that these words have to really, really be the anchor for our soul. And I believe they're a word for you today. Psalms 39, verse 7 from the New King James, I read. It says, Lord, what do I wait for? Just circle the word wait. We'll get back to that. Lord, what do I wait for? And then he says these 5 words, my hope is in you. Underline the word you. What he's saying is, even if, or in my situation, even if the pills don't work, or even if I can't get an appointment, or even if I can't get healed, or maybe for you, the job doesn't come, or maybe you've tried to get free and no one can help you, even when it seems like nothing is working, you've got to have as a Christian this anchor that says, my hope is not in that, is not in this, but my hope is in you. My hope is in you, Jesus. And that is the sermon I'm preaching today. Simple. My hope is in you. And I'm here to encourage you that because of Jesus, you have a vibrant expectation of what lies ahead, because your hope in reality doesn't lie primarily in other things. It lies in him. My hope is in you. And I believe it's a word in season, because I just feel in my spirit, there's people there and you need something to happen. You, as I'm stood in the UK and you're there in Sydney, you need something to happen in your life. You're in pain, mental pain, emotional pain, relational pain, financial pain. Maybe you need the breakthrough. Maybe you're in that place where you're stuck and things aren't changing, or you need a job. But I have a question for you. And this is point number one. What is your hope in? You need a breakthrough, right? What is your hope in? Because this verse says, gives us a reason of why so many people end up hopeless. This verse gives us a clear reason why many people walk away from Jesus, walk away from church, walk away from marriages and life. They throw in the towel, they give up on friendships. You know why? Because their hope is not actually in God. Think about this. We say, I hope I get this job. So let's ask the question, what's the hope in? It's probably in our intellect or our skill. I hope the weather is good today. We use the word hope all the time like that, right? But what is our hope in? Probably what our hope is in something that we can't control. We say, oh, you know, I really hope she's okay. We use the word hope, but what is our hope in when we say those things? When we say, I hope you get the job, what's your anchor in? It's got to be in Jesus. When I say, I hope the weather's good, it's got to be in something bigger and better. What is your hope in? What is it anchored to? Maybe for some of you there this morning, and for me, I know, maybe your hope is linked and anchored to ability, experience, and skill. You know, the reality is those things are fantastic, but all the time they often come up limited. Luke 5 says the disciples fished all night, but they couldn't catch anything. These were trained fishermen. They had ability, skill, and experience. But you know, the reality is it wasn't enough. You know what they needed? They needed Jesus. They needed to realize my hope is in you, and it is. Maybe you're depending on not ability, skill, or experience. Maybe you're depending on a man or a woman. Well, if he changes, if I get married, if I could just find that person, come on, somebody, you're not being real with me. You know, think about John 4. Jesus met a woman at the well. Six men couldn't solve her issues. You could say six women couldn't solve a man's issues. This woman had been in relationship after relationship, but the truth is, even if a hope is in a man or a woman, it can be limited. She needed Jesus. Where is your hope anchored? My hope is in you, is what we've got to say. Maybe it's in experts, or maybe it's in time. You know, sometimes we're like, you know, over time it will change. You think about Luke 8, the woman with the hemorrhage. For 12 years, she had this same hemorrhage. Doctors couldn't fix it. Time didn't heal it. In fact, it probably made it worse. The truth is, it wasn't enough. What she needed was a touch of Jesus Christ, and she found that. And she realized that the truth of the matter, the number one foundation of Christian life is, my hope is in you, i.e. when all else fails. When the engineers and the doctors and the psychologists can't help, and they're fantastic in all they do, and I thank God for them. But when that comes limited, you still have God, my friend. Could you just do me a favor? Turn to your neighbor and say to them, you still have God. The truth is, time doesn't change it all. Wishing doesn't make it better. Often that's why we get hopeless, because we hope in something, not in someone. The truth about hope is to really walk free from church today and live in a hope. You really have to know that your hope is anchored to something bigger, better, and mightier than you, that has no limits and no boundaries. It was transcendent. And there is only one person I know like that, and his name is Jesus. I'm here to tell you, my friend, your hope is in him. Your hope is in him. You know, the truth is, so often we get hope and optimism mixed up. Lift your hand if you're an optimist. Okay. Two. Lift your hand if you're a pessimist. Okay, no one's being honest. All right, thank you, brother. Okay, both. All right, that's good. You see, often we get hope and optimism mixed up. Optimism is how we see things, right? Pessimism, oh yeah, I'm a pessimistic person, or I'm a optimistic. It's about what we see. That isn't hope. Biblical hope is not looking at things the way you see things. It's looking at the way God sees things. It's standing on what his word says about it. It's standing on what his promises explain about that thing. hope isn't optimism because it's not built on us. It's built on his power. It's built on his wisdom. That's why both optimist and pessimist can believe God. Amen. Both optimists and pessimists can believe God because every single person that I'm looking at right now, beautiful, awesome people there in Sydney, all sun-kissed with the sunshine, every single one of you has the ability to hope because it isn't based on you or me or anyone else or optimism or pessimism or upbringing. Everyone has the opportunity to stand on his word and declare, the Bible says. That's what hope is. My hope is in you. I guess that's the point. Where does your hope lie? The only place to put your hope is Jesus. And if everything has failed so far, my friend, I'm telling you, you have not run out of options. You still have God. The Bible says, you know, think about it on our terms, on mine and Lisa's. I've said this before. You know, medically, we've been told we have a 5% chance of having children. Now that's probably minus 5% because that was years ago, 12 years ago. The truth is, but biblically, I have 100% chance. Because the Bible says from a man, and I say it, the Bible says from a man as good as dead came descendants. So the Bible, the key is, where is my hope? When medics can't fix it, when time doesn't change it, when in fact time makes it go negative, not positive, then where is my hope? My hope has to be in the Bible says, for as man as good as dead came descendants. Where is your hope, my friend? Is your hope in God, that he can change them, that he can do this for you, that he can save your kids, that he can change you? Put your hope in him. Put it this way, scientifically, you tell me, what is the percentage of rising from the dead without any medical help? There's a 0% chance, right? Scientifically, that's right. 0% chance scientifically without medical help of rising from the dead. But what about biblically? 100% chance, because everyone will rise. The issue is, when you face a problem, where does your hope lie? And today, my aim is that you would begin to put your hope in Jesus. You would say, my hope is in you, O God. And you begin to receive as a miracle the breakthrough that you desperately need. Here's point two, simply this, put your hope in God. And I'm speaking to people that are struggling and challenged and need breakthrough, and time is against you. I'm here to declare to you this morning, put your hope in God. Romans 15:13 says, and gives him a title, he's called the God of hope. That's Romans 15:13, the God of hope. You know, just in the short years of ministry or even being saved, what was it, 2002? So yeah, 20 years saved in ministry and pioneering. Listen, I've seen God move as you have. I've seen Satanists get saved. I'll tell you about him in a minute, actually. I've seen suicidal people find church the day before they take their life. I've seen heroin addicts get delivered. I've seen marriages turn around that were broken. I've seen x-rays of tumors shrink. I've seen paralysis fall at the name of Jesus before my eyes. I've planted churches. We've sent out couples. I've preached in nations. I've changed countries. I've fought spiritual battles. And I'm here to say this. Number one thing, God has never, never let me down. And he's never going to let you down, my friend. Put your hope in God. You know what one man said to me years ago, and I wrote it down and I've kept it in my Bible. He said, there are no hopeless situations. There are only people who have grown hopeless about them. How true is that? When you serve Jesus, think about the God who can do anything. There are actually no hopeless situations. But what we struggle with is there are people like you and I who have grown hopeless about them. And I'm here to, in the name of Jesus, push away that hopelessness and say, put your hope in God. Because in a season and a country and a nation of viruses and gender challenges and war and economic predictions and political and social unrest, listen, in these last days, you're going to have to anchor your hope on something bigger than policy and bigger than our own selves. We're going to have to anchor our hope on the God of the book of Psalms, Psalms 20, verse 7. Psalms 20, verse 7, some trust in chariots, some in horses. But we, the Bread of Life family, we trust in the name of the Lord our God. Psalms 121:1 says a similar thing. Psalms 121:1 says, I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence cometh my help? And he's asking a question, from whence, or as in, where's my help going to come from? He says, my help comes from the Lord. And I'm here to direct you back to the one who can work this for you, who can change and fix and heal and resolve this. My hope is in you, is what David said. In the midst of all of his problems, he reminded his soul, you know what, God? No matter what's going on, my hope is in you. And when it's anchored there, you'll never fail. Matthew Henry said these words in his commentary. He said, we must not rely upon men and means, instruments and second causes. Shall I depend upon the strength of the hills, upon great men? No, my confidence is in God, and I will lift my eyes above the hills and look to God. My hope is in him. I love that. It doesn't nullify the help of people, but the truth is it lifts you to a higher standard, to the God that loves you and is for you. That today we're going to put, I have an altar, we're going to put our trust in him, and we're going to say, God, I'm trusting you to provide. God, I'm trusting you to help our marriage. God, I'm trusting you to fix me. God, I'm trusting you to build our church. And we are going to trust and put our hope in him. Put your hope in God, my friend. You know, I had a really interesting accidental meeting with someone. We're visiting some people recently, just spoke in the UK. And I bumped into a guy called Jay. Jay was in our church for years. And this meeting just encouraged me. I remember we were talking on the street, and I remember when he called me. He's still in the church there back in the UK where we pioneered. I remember when he called me, I just heard this voice. And he goes, it's an international voice. And he said, yeah, my name's Jay. I need your help. I've got there's some darkness around my life, and I got a flyer with your number on. He began to tell me his story. So I had coffee with him. He'd just come out of prison. He'd spent 5 years with international drug charges. He was a Muslim. And he became a Satanist while he was in prison. He was a Satanist for 4 years. And in his final year in prison, someone gave him a Bible. One of his inmates gave him a Bible and said, you know, you ought to try Jesus. And he got released after that. He said he kind of thought, well, maybe I can. He got released. And so he finds a flyer and he calls me. And I said, met him and I chatted to him. And I prayed for him, but nothing major happened. And then I invited him to church. I said, you need to come church. You need to be in the house of God. You've been behind bars and now it's time to be in his house. And he walked into church, and I remember seeing him, big beard, a Muslim, and I got the leaders over, you know, got the Peters and the James and all the people and the Evelyns and everyone around there, all the whole Bread of Life church, and brought them, and we laid hands on him right there, and we just cast out darkness, and we just cast out demons, and we just pray, hey, listen, you know what it's like, you cast out anything you can cast out, you just praying for him, and we laid hands on him, and that day he got saved, radically saved. Filled with the Holy Ghost the next week. But what was so encouraging about this meeting is for years he was in church, but he wasn't really firing on all cylinders. You know what I mean? He hadn't, you know, and what was encouraging is when I met him this last week, he said, yeah, I'm preaching. I'm leading outreaches. I'm leading worship. I'm full of God. And I was so encouraged. And I stood there looking at him like a different man, a Muslim, a Satanist, 5 year international drug charges, full of Jesus. All I could say is this, put your hope in God, my friend. Put your hope in God. There is nothing and no one that God can't change. And that goes for your life too. You may not be in that severe case, but you may face severe situations in life. Put your hope in God and believe him. But here's the question. What do we do with hope? Do we just wait and sit around and be lazy and just like, you know, what do we, you know? Okay, I hope, Pastor Dan, I hope. My hope is in God, but what do I do now? Do I do nothing? Do I just wait? Well, it's interesting in our text. David uses the word wait. He says, Lord, what do I wait for? My hope is in you. But the word wait in Hebrew there is chova, but it's an active verb. It's in its active form. It has a letter on the end that makes it an active verb. What he's saying is, or his mind is, the hope that I have is not dormant. It's not just sitting there waiting, wishing. You think about David, who wrote this psalm. He lived with this hope in God, but he expanded geographical boundaries. He rebuilt Jerusalem as a religious center. He composed psalms. He united the 12 tribes. He made preparations for the temple. You could say this guy was active, yet he was waiting on God with a hope in him. Why? Because his hope, yes, was in God. My hope was in you, but it was an active hope. It was a hope that wasn't dormant. And so I close on this third point. Hope is never dormant. Because the reality is, I preach on hope and people are like, yeah, I'm stirred, I'm hope. But the reality of hope is hope prays, hope fasts, hope confesses the promises, hope gets up, sets the alarm, hope attempts to apply for the job you can't get. Hope is never dormant. It's an active verb in the life of a Christian. Let me show you what I mean. Just turn your Bibles quickly to Jeremiah 25, or your phones or your iPads. Jeremiah 29. We know this. We're going to read verse 5 and verse 6, and then we're going to read verse 11. That's it. Three verses. Jeremiah 29, verse 5, verse 6, and then verse 11. God is speaking to a people who are in captivity, hopeless. And he says these words. He says in verse 5, build houses and dwell in them. Build is a verb. Plant gardens, plant. Eat the fruit. Take, verb. Take wives, beget sons and daughters. What he's saying is get active. He says build houses, dwell in them. Plant gardens, eat their fruit. Take wives, beget sons and daughters. He's saying get active. And he says these words in verse 5, that you may be increased there and not diminished. He says, I don't want you to survive in Babylon. I want you to thrive in Babylon. But here's the why. Verse 11 says, for I know the thoughts I think toward you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you a future. And you can say these words, and a hope. What he's intimating at in the entire Jeremiah 29 is this. We usually end on verse 11. God's got a future and a hope. Backtrack to verse 5, and God says, listen, yes, there's a hope. I've given you a hope. Your hope is in me, but this hope ain't dormant. This hope is building houses and dwelling in them. This hope is planting gardens and eating fruit. This hope is taking wives and begetting sons. It's talking about fruitfulness. It's talking about activity. And he says, because I want you to increase and not diminish. He's saying, yes, there's hope, but hope isn't dormant, my friend. And so I'm encouraging you today with the hope that I'm preaching today, with your maybe newfound hope in God or reminder that God is your answer, that you leave church service today and you start building again and you start planting again and you start praying again. You set the alarm. It doesn't matter if you feel far from God. You're never far from God. You can't be. He's transcendent. He's everywhere. It feels like you're far from God, but one prayer brings you right back into his presence. Dream again, plan again, strategize, study, pursue. There is hope with God, but it's never dormant. The truth is you can't really hope in God and sit waiting for things to change. The truth is you can do that. But one person said to me years ago that stuck with me, and that is this. God gives you hope not to sit on, but to stand on. God gives you hope not to sit on. Like, hey, this is a nice sermon. I'm hoping to go, but to stand on and say, God, you Bible says. Put it practically. That means if you stand on hope and hope isn't dormant, hope will make you productive. If you're hoping for your business, you got to book those meetings. You got to complete that course. Because it's not dormant. Hope makes you proactive. You got to hope for that marriage, right? But it makes you proactive. You book time to communicate. You plan those days out. You sit down and talk. Why? Because it's something you do know. Because your hope is in God that this can work. But your hope is active. It's we're going to go somewhere. Because my hope is active. I'm waiting. It's an active verb. I'm waiting on the Lord. Yes, but I'm talking. I'm speaking. We're planning. You following me, church? Give me a wave if you're following me. Hope isn't dormant. Hope makes you pray. You're hoping for your family. or plan that fast. Go and lay hands on that house that you want to buy. Come on, somebody. Go, listen, I've laid hands on church buildings and received them. I've laid hands on houses and got them. I've even gone in, I've done it there in Bread of Life. I'd lay hands on the chairs and say, God, fill these seats with people that don't know you. Because hope is active. It's never dormant. It's praying, it's fasting, it's confessing. It's going forward. And above all, hope makes you unstoppable. Because you know what hope does? It absorbs discouragement. You know, when you try and it doesn't work, if your hope is in God and it's active, it absorbs discouragement. It outlasts the disappointment. It prays, it praises, it perseveres, and it stands on his promises. My hope is in you. But that hope I have in you, God, isn't dormant. It's active. Let me close on this. You know, Lisa and I, while being away and just being here and seeing my mom and helping her recover, I've just been really planning and strategizing and praying for you, for Bread of Life, for our church, for our city, for our community. And, you know, why would we do that? Why do we do that? Not only because it's a job. No, it's more than a job. It's a calling. Not only because we love you, and not only because I totally believe in you and everyone in the church and believe in the future, but the reality is our hope is in him. Our hope is in him, but the hope we have isn't going to remain dormant. We're planning and strategizing and drawing and writing. Why? Because our hope is in him and it's active. And so let me encourage you, when we get back next week, let's be ready. Turn to your neighbor and say, are you ready? Are you ready? Well, yeah, I'm ready. Well, are you hoping? Are you hoping for our church? Are you hoping for our community? Well, next week, let's be ready. And let's hope in God, believe we're going to have an awesome service, believe God for our future, but we're going to make that hope active. Let's arrive early to pray. Prayer rooms open an hour before, 30 minutes before. Let's get early and pray. Let's invite our friends. Let's fast together. Let's seek his face. Let's begin to strategize and look for buildings and reach our community for Jesus. Why? Because our hope, Bread of Life, is in him. Our hope is in him, but it's going to be active. It's going to be active. And the same goes for your life. I don't know what you're facing. I don't know what is challenging you. I don't know what you're stuck in. But my hope is in him for your life. And that is what I want you to leave with today. And so let's pray. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. And we're going to pray. Worship team can come if they want to and minister over the people with music if they want to. But let's bow our heads and let's close our eyes. And I want you to just begin to think. There's things in your life. There's something you need to happen. There's pain. There's breakthrough that needs to occur. Things are stuck. There's people that need saving. There's jobs that need having. I want you to come in a moment, whether you do it on your seat or whether you do it on the altar. And I want you to come and I want you to bring that specific situation to the altar. And I want you to say, God, my hope is in you. Work a miracle. Work a miracle. So let's take time right now, these next 5 minutes, whether you do it on your seat, whether you come to the altar, I want you to bring that thing and I want you to lay it before the living God and say, God, my hope is in you, and begin to say it and say it and believe for a miracle. Come on, let's pray. Let's have an altar, church. Father, I just pray for your precious people as they're coming before you, as they're looking at the situations that they face. Father, I just pray for them right now. Every roadblock, every hindrance, every question that needs answering, God, jobs that need releasing, contracts that need signing, addictions that need breaking, minds that need freeing. God, I'm interceding for every single person right now. There, God, in Sydney, doesn't matter where we are, you're transcendent. You're right there as you are here. And I pray, help them, God. My help comes from the Lord. Their help is from you, oh God. Help them, I pray, supernaturally. Give them an acceleration and a momentum. Do things that no man can do, that no medic can do, that no one else can do. Oh God, help them, I pray, right now. And let there be testimonies of breakthrough. Let there be testimonies of breakthrough that resonate through this church and above all, glorify the name of Jesus, for our hope is in you. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. The bread of life shouted super loud. Amen, amen, amen. God bless you. God bless you guys. It's so wonderful to be with you. Yeah, you can give me a wave. Show me those armpits. Show me those hands. That's right. So many faces I see. Hey, okay. I'm loving you guys too. Sending the love. Sending the love. If that's love, it's like a YMCA thing we're going on here. Oh, it's so lovely to see you all and to see even some new faces. But I'm going to leave you in the awesome hands of Pastor Peter and the team. And so we look forward to seeing you next week. We're going to eat some English shortbread together, eat some sweets, and have a time in Jesus. Amen. God bless you guys. Love you.